everyone. Thank you for joining us today as we start this new series, Journey to the Resurrection. This series, we focus on how to prepare ourselves for the Holy Lent and how to have a blessed and a fruitful time of it. We will focus more on how to read and understand the Gospels and the Matins and the Vespers and how we could benefit from them to the utmost of them. Today, we are blessed to have Father Mark Aziz with us from St. Mark Coptic Orthodox Church of Washington, D.C., who will lead us into this journey. And Abuna, we're very excited for you to explain a lot of things to us, because I could speak for myself. I don't think I'm ever prepared for the Lent.
Good. It's time to be prepared.
Right. And I think one of the things that we read overlook sometimes in the liturgy is a phrase that we say. And in, when I was preparing for the Lent itself, like for the readings for this, I thought of three things actually that the Lent asks us to focus on: giving, prayer, and fasting. But I think when we were talking, you mentioned also forgiveness as one of them. So when I listened in the liturgy, I heard a phrase that was very interesting, that holies for the holy, the holies for the holy.
Yes.
So how can we think of that a little bit more? Can you explain a little bit more what that really means?
Yes. I heard many myths around it, because sometimes people said, when we hear it, I am hesitant to have communion. Or when we hear it, I feel that I'm not worthy to have the communion. Part of what they are saying is true, but we need to dig deeper to find why the church is insisting to hear it. The holies are for the holy. And then in the end, most of us, if not all of us, proceed to the communion. Because it's very deep, and there is nothing in our liturgy that is not related to our daily life. Of course, the story starts a little bit earlier than that. When we pray the invocation of the Holy Spirit, the priest is praying that the Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, which is the bread and wine. So church is telling us there are two miracles happening in one go. The priest is asking the Holy Spirit to descend upon us to convert the repented people, the congregation, into the holy, or to be saints. Through the work of the Holy Spirit, through their journey during the week, by repenting and confessing our sins to the church. And then in the end, Abuna is praying the holies are for the holy. It's not to say something not real. It happened already during the invocation of the Holy Spirit. But we need to notice here something very important. It's Abuna is asking first that the Holy Spirit may descend upon us. We argue a lot with other denominations about the real presence of the body and blood of Christ. But unfortunately, you forgot that we are also transformed in this liturgy, in each liturgy, from being sinners, repented, and then now we are called to be holy. And then in the very end, after Abuna is praying, the holies are for the holy, the congregation immediately reply, one is the Holy Father, one is the Holy Son, one is the Holy Spirit. What does it mean? It's again the humble mind of the church. Yes, the holies are for the holy. Yes, the Holy Spirit has sanctified us all. But there is something very important. We know that we don't deserve it. So we say and confess out loud, it's only the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit are holy. And because of what the Trinity has done for us, and the Holy Spirit converted us from repented sinners into the holy, then we get the blessing and the power of the body and the blood of Christ in the end. So we'll find it, it's a gift from the Trinity first, that we ask the Holy Spirit to descend upon us and upon this gift. Then we are out loud joyfully saying the holies are for the holy, and humbly the church is saying one is the Holy Father, one is the Holy Son, one is the Holy Spirit.
I'm assuming that the holies for the holy means forgiving others before receiving the holy
Definitely
communion.
Part of it. That's why you'll find, maybe we can discuss this phrase someone in another episode, the liturgy starts with the holy kiss.
Yes.
Which means I profess and proclaim I have forgiven every member, not only in the church, any member of the body of Christ, wherever he is.
Great. And that's great, Abuna. And with that, we're going to stop with a short break and we'll be right back. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. We are still here with Father Mark discussing our first episode on Siri, on the Siri Journey to the Resurrection. And Father Mark had previously discussed with us forgiveness. Abuna, can you explain to us how is forgiveness tied with this week's readings and Matins and Vesper and Gospel?
Yes. You know, the Church is always trying to prepare our minds in a very simple and deep way in the same time. So, for example, in the Gospel of the Vespers, it was from Mark chapter 11, verse 22 to verse 26. So the last two verses, it says, "And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses." So because we are going to start the Lent, and by the way, as I mentioned before, the break, always the beginning of the liturgy. The anaphora starts always with the Holy Kiss. What does it mean, a Holy Kiss? It means I accepted to forgive every member of the whole body. Sometimes we misuse it. So if I have a problem with you, I will go to another church and pray.
So I don't have to kiss.
No, I feel more comfortable that you are not in the church, which is, again, it's defeating the whole purpose.
Yes.
It's the Holy Kiss, yes. I'm kissing the three people around me, but in the same time, I profess out loud in front of God and in front of everybody that I accepted to forgive anyone in the body of Christ, even those who passed away. Sometimes I feel comfortable that someone is not in my life anymore.
They're dead.
But still, I need to release forgiveness to this person. Mm. And if you see it, it's the only condition. Yani, you will find it. Here, the Lord is saying, if, whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him. In the other gospel, he was telling us, even if you put your offering in front of the altar, and you remember that your brother has something against you, go and forgive him, and reconcile, or at least do it properly before you start your liturgy. Why again? Because the Lord was conditioning it. He's saying, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. But definitely, forgiveness is very hard. And this is the message of the gospel of the Matins. So he was telling them, which is very strange. Take heed, the gospel of the Matins is Luke chapter 17 from verse 3 to 10. Take heed to yourselves, if your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day, and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. Up to here, it looks a repetition for what you have read in the Vespers. But what is very important is the response of the apostles. Then the apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. Strangely enough, we didn't hear them asking the Lord to increase their faith when he raised Lazarus, or when he told them, go and preach and cast out demons. But once he was telling them, you have to forgive, they asked him,
for faith,
increase our faith. So that's why it's very essential. Sometimes it looks very hard. That's why we believe it's a divine act. The grace of God and the Holy Spirit is encouraging us to do it through our new man. And this is part of our journey to the resurrection or during the Lent. We need to understand how to do it and the need of doing it with everyone, especially those ones that I'm naming them, except this one.
So, Abuna, I'm just looking a little bit more into Luke 17. When he said, if your brother sins against you, rebuke him, and if he repents, forgive him. So, should we be looking for the forgiveness from the other person, not ourselves asking for this person to forgive, mm-hmm. forgive us, or like it's a mutual
act,
yeah.
I think we are mixing up a few things together here.
Yeah.
You know, let's say someone did something bad to me
mm-hmm.
yesterday.
Yes.
So we have past and present and future. For yesterday, he did something bad to me, or at least I have seen it as he did something bad to me.
Yes.
For the past, God is asking me to forgive him without his participation.
Right.
It's between me and God. It's something in my heart. Then there is something in the present. We need to reconcile. Reconciliation, there is no commandment to say you have to reconcile with everyone, unless there is another commandment. If this is my brother or my father or my wife, I have to reconcile. But there is no commandment to say reconcile with everyone. Because reconciliation needs both of us to cooperate. If you refuse to reconcile, God is not going to tell me something. For the future, we need to rebuild the trust. And again, there is no commandment to say you have to trust everyone. Because it affects the other person. I can't force you to trust me once more after what has been done. So regarding the past, it's my duty towards God and towards myself to forgive. For the present, reconciliation, there is no commandments because it's between you and me, and if you refuse, I can't force you to do it. For the future, we need a trust, and to rebuild the trust, it's again a mutual act between me and you.
So tying this back to the Lent, I'm assuming, or I'm gathering from what you're saying, that's very important for us to forgive prior to starting the Lent, as if we already haven't done it, if something we haven't done so.
Yes, there's a big difference between forgiving and walking in the walk of the forgiveness. What does it mean? Forgiveness is not a button I'm going to press. So I know there's something in my heart towards someone. At least in the journey, or at the beginning of the journey, I have to decide I want to forgive. Maybe I can't tell now. Why again? If this is God's side and this is the enemy's side, by saying I will never forgive you, unfortunately I am in the opposite side.
Yes.
Once I say I want to forgive but I can't, nothing has been changed yet in my heart. But I moved from here to the camp of God. So maybe at the beginning of the Lent, every one of us has to decide I want to forgive but maybe I can't tell now. Then go and talk to your father of confession. Go and read books about forgiveness. Go and read passages, for example, Matthew chapter 18. Then you will learn how to do it during the Lent through the grace of God, through the work of the Holy Spirit. That's why even why the Lord said to his disciples, this kind cannot come out by anything except by prayer and fasting. The spirit of unforgiveness is attacking me. How to conquer it? Through fasting and prayer. In your daily prayers, put this person in your prayers. In every liturgy, if we believe that the liturgy is an exchange of life, I'm coming to have to put my heart, which is full of unforgiveness, to receive the heart of Christ. To put my mind, which is saying you don't deserve this forgiveness, and to obtain the mind of Christ, who is willing on the cross to forgive each and every one.
So putting this all in perspective, when we say we're preparing for the Lent, it's an ongoing process through the whole entire Lent.
But at least take the right decision to move from the rejecting to forgive to I am willing to forgive, but I can't do it. Help me, Lord. And then you will receive the power and the help.
So, Abuna, you mentioned that we have to have the will to want to forgive somebody.
Yeah.
And then during the Lent, we ask for help
to do it.
To do it, actually. Yeah. But can you go a little bit more in depth about what it takes and what we need to actually do?
Yes. I will tell you, I'll give you a very simple example. So let's say someone hurt me. Unfortunately, you'll find people keeping this hurt for a long time. So I remember till today that you did something to me 5 years ago and 10 years ago, and sometimes we have wounds from our childhood. So there's few facts I need to know at first. This happened maybe 10 years ago or 20 years ago, in 1 minute, in 1 hour, whatever it is. Keeping it till today, I'm extending the pain for 10 years while it happened for 1 minute.
Yes.
So what I can do now, I can't change what happened, but I can change what is going on now. One of the lies in my mind, when I keep this grudge inside me, I'm torturing you, while it's totally the opposite. I'm torturing myself till today I'm reminding myself that you did so and so. So I have extended the pain of few minutes or few hours or even few years to be my whole life. So what I can do now, that as I said, we have no buttons to press. So I'm praying every day to this person who hurt me in a way or another. And I'm expressing my real feelings. I'm not going to lie. That's why we said, I want to forgive. It doesn't mean that I'm releasing you from the responsibility of what you have done against me. So I'm praying, Lord, this person, by his name, has done so and so to me. Still the grudge inside me. Still I am sad. Still I am in pain because what he or she has done to me. But Lord, I know these feelings are not from you. And I'm asking you to release from my heart this bondage of unforgiveness. And I'm asking you, Lord, to pour out in my heart this flow of forgiveness as you have done it on the cross. I didn't change what has been done. I didn't change even my feelings. But my willingness, it allows and opens the door to the Holy Spirit and the grace of God to work on me. But once if I'm resisting this, I'm in the wrong direction. So just release your emotion as it is. Confess it before the Lord and tell him, it's not from you. That's why I don't want to have it. Work on me and change my heart and my mind.
I think it's very hard, Abuna, for some people to make it into that willing part, or to even make it to that part of willing to forgive, I mean, because there's some people who have been through so many different hurts in life.
Yes.
Stuff like, for example, people that have been abused, people that have been raped, people that have family members that have been killed. How do you forgive that person who have done that hurt to them willingly and accept it, accept the change that comes from the praying and fasting and, you know, truly asking God for forgiveness?
Yes. If you go back to Matthew chapter 18, the Lord is giving us a very nice analogy or parable, and he was explaining to us in a very nice way. So Matthew chapter 18 and verse 21. Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Jesus said to him, I don't say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven, 490. What does it mean?
It's a lot.
It's a lot, and you can't make it, by the way. So why the Lord is trying to tell us, it's not a human act, it's a divine act. That's why the remaining part of the parable was telling us about the man who was in debt for 10,000, and there was no way for the one who was in debt to repay it. It says something very moving to see it's a divine act. But submit your will. He said in verse 27, the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. Who is able to move you with compassion? It's the Holy Spirit. It's God himself. That's why when I share just in the willingness, the miracle will happen. But as far as I'm resisting, I'm stopping the miracle to happen in my life. So maybe my prayer, that's why it's very important to take the guidance of your spiritual father, your father of compassion. Now he can lead you in a prayer. He can lead you in a certain reading to be able to have the will to move yourself in the camp of God. And then the work of the Holy Spirit will start to move your heart into compassion.
So with that, Abuna, are we going to take a quick break, and then we'll be right back to learn a little bit more about forgiveness and how we could ask for it during this Holy Lent. Welcome back, everyone, as you join us for the last segment of our series, Journey to the Resurrection. We're back with Abuna Mark Aziz from St. Mark Church in Washington, D.C. Abuna, we were just talking about forgiveness and having the willing act to do it, or taking the willing act upon it first. It seems like a very intimate thing to do,
yeah.
But so is the whole Lent relationship.
Yes.
Because there's also fasting and praying and giving.
Yes.
In addition to forgiveness. So it seems like the Lent is very full of building a relationship with God more than what we do throughout the year. Why is that?
It's yes and no, in fact.
Okay.
Yes, we say it's the spring of the spiritual life, but it doesn't mean that the spring will end.
Mm.
We reinitiate things that maybe stopped in my life for a long time, but it's not an end when the resurrection has come. So we need to see that it's re-equipping every one of us to start the journey of life. Yes, it's journey to resurrection, and then it's not finished. Some people ask that next year I'm going also to fast. Why? Because the journey is towards eternity. St. Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3, we are aiming to the full stature of Christ, which is journey to eternity. Yes, last year I had the same journey, and it puts me in a certain level. This year I'm having the same journey, because not because I returned back, because I need to advance in my journey, because it's a journey to the full stature of Christ.
Okay.
That's why the whole theme of the readings of the liturgy, it's about internal, personal, deep relationship with the Holy Trinity, with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. It's not about showing that I'm fasting or praying or I'm attending liturgy, how to deepen this personal, internal relationship with God, Father and Son and Holy Spirit.
Can you go a little bit more about making it as an action of showing, but an action of acting?
Yes, because it's eternal or internal relationship, even if you go through the readings, you will find every reading is showing us there is something deeper than being, for example, in the Pauline epistle. St. Paul is a great servant who served and preached in 23 cities in his lifetime. And he wrote, of course, the 14 epistles. Find at the very end of the Pauline epistle, St. Paul was telling them, last verse we read on the first week, we read from 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 16 to 28. So he was telling them, besides the other things, what comes upon me daily, my deep concern for all the churches in 23 cities. No one can see your deep concern about anything else. But because he has this personal, internal, deep relationship with the Holy Trinity, he has a deep concern for all the churches. So, always the Pauline epistle is telling us there is an issue and there is a fact. Have a deep concern about your spiritual life. Have a deep concern about your own ministry. Even if you are serving in the smallest, there's no small and big ministry, of course, but even if you feel that you are doing the least in the church, have a deep concern about it. Then you will find all the readings taking the same theme during the whole liturgy.
Okay. Abuna, can you tell us a little bit more about how the Catholic epistles for the reading for that day ties into all of this?
Yes. St. Paul, always in his epistles, he's trying to give us a key to something new in our spiritual life. The Catholic epistle is always showing us the internal act of God in our life. So if we read from the beginning, we read from 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 to 11. So the first verse says, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. If you imagine for this calling, it's very easy to say, I'm weak, as we were speaking about the forgiveness. I can't do it. I can't make it.
Great.
Think of three things. First of all, Jesus Christ himself was able to forgive on the cross those who crucified him. In the book of Acts chapter 7, we have seen St. Stephen doing the same act, forgiving, from where you got it. Hear what St. Peter is telling us. To those who have obtained like precious faith with us. We don't have anything less than St. Peter and St. Paul and St. Stephen. How? In a very simple way. When I was baptized, I received the same power of the death and resurrection of Christ. When I have communion, I have the same power of the body and the blood of Christ. So the Catholic epistle is telling us, you have already precious faith with us, like us, all the apostles. That's why what Jesus did, has been given to the church. That's why the following verse 3, it says, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. So it's very easy, as you said, it's hard. It's hard for you and hard for me. Mm-hmm. But if his divine power has given us to us all things that pertain to life and goodness, we are able to make it. Not by our own
will,
but by our own cooperation with our free will to say to the grace of God, yes, I received. When I was baptized, I received the full power of his death and resurrection. When I have the communion, I receive the full power of the life of Christ flowing in me.
Mm. So which one comes first, the faith or the forgiveness?
Definitely, every single thing in our life is a divine human act. If I can't receive the divine, I can't do it by my own.
Mm.
So here St. Peter is telling us, as his divine power has given to us. But the problem is, sometimes I don't know that it was given to me. Mm. That's why when we insist to read the Word of God, to know what I have in my account already, then to use it by cooperating with my free will to what I have been given. That's why he's saying at the very end of the reading, verse 10, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. What does it mean? What is my election and call to be sure? That his divine power has given me everything that pertains to life and goods. You miss nothing.
Mm-hmm.
But use what you have. Know it first, believe it, and work with the new equipment that the Holy Spirit has given to you.
And how does the book of Acts tie into this?
Yes, the book of Acts is always showing us an example of what is explained in the Pauline and the Catholic Epistle. The Catholic Epistle was showing us that we have been re-equipped. His divine power has given us everything that pertains to life and goodness.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the book of Acts, chapter 21, in this week, verse 15 to 26. Because it's about internal, personal relationship with the Holy Trinity, we need to feel the need of the whole church internally. It's not, I'm in this side, so I'm not concerned about your side. And the reading was showing us what happened in chapter 15 in the book of Acts. The first ecumenical council, if you can call it the ecumenical council, or the first council in the church in Jerusalem. And it says, but concerning the Gentiles who believe, we have written and decided that they should observe no such thing, except that they should keep themselves from things offered to idols, from blood, from things strangled, and from sexual immorality. What does it mean again? Because one of the biggest problems in the early church, those who called Judaizers, they want everyone to follow all the laws of the Old Testament as if Christ didn't come.
Mm-hmm.
Or they add to Christ. That's why the whole epistle of St. Paul to the Galatians was against those Judaizers. That the law was leading us to see that we are in need of a Savior. The Savior has come and he has completed everything in his perfect sacrifice.
Hmm. So earlier on we mentioned that the forgiveness, the fasting and prayers and giving, they're all a personal relationship with God.
Yes.
We're creating a personal relationship with God during that time. But in here it mentions that we're also concerning or looking in concern for the well-being of others.
Yes.
How is that all tied up? Because usually like we, when we're trying to work on ourselves, we're focused so much on what we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
Or I would imagine like I'm so focused on like how I'm fasting, how I'm praying, how I'm forgiving, what I need to give. Versus, oh, let me think now about everyone else in my church or my community, or even as a church, as a one church body of Christ.
If we think of every single thing in the church, whether prayer or fasting, or it's a restoration of the whole man,
mm.
of the whole personhood. So if I'm restored, I will never be selfish.
Mm.
So when we think of it and only during the time of the Lent, I'm restoring myself, which is true. But the restoration of my personhood through Christ, through the work of the Holy Trinity, makes me a living member of a body.
Mm.
I can't say, it's not my business. I don't care about you. That's why the church mind always is about the wholeness of a living member in the living body of Christ. It's not only about me. And that's why the church is always thinking both ways. You know, there is a corporate act for the body, and there is a personal act between me and the head of the body, Christ himself.
So it's pretty much an action that happens without us knowing it's happening. It kind of happens on its
part
own
of the
as
restoration.
We're,
yes,
as
part
we're restoring
of the restoration.
Ourselves. I want to talk to us a little bit about the meaning of giving and prayer and fasting.
Yeah, especially in this week or the Lent Sunday,
yeah.
He's not talking much about the content, how to pray, how to give. It's mainly about, is it a secret personal relationship between you and God? Or again, I'm showing off that I'm fasting, I'm giving, I'm doing it. That's why we'll find the key word he spoke. It's in Matthew chapter 6, verse 1 to 18, about giving, prayer, forgiveness, and fasting. The key word that ends every paragraph is as such, that your charitable deed may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will he himself reward you openly. So if I'm not keen to have any spiritual act in secret, it makes me, again, losing the reward. The Lord said it many times before. You have taken your reward on earth. You received enough praise that you have done whatever you have done. And even sometimes we are puzzled. The Lord was telling us, don't allow your right hand to know what is your left hand has done or vice versa.
Mm.
How come? How come I can hide what I have done by this hand from this hand? And when the church father tried to explain it more, it's not to be something secretive in front of my eyes, but in front of my heart. So what I have done, if, for example, I'm helping someone, maybe he's very thankful for what I have helped him. But deep within, I feel I have done nothing. Even the Lord himself said, if you do all righteousness, say you are not worthy of what you are doing.
So humbling yourself?
In reality, it's not a word I'm going to say it in front of you. That's why it said an internal, deep, personal relationship inside me. I can do all these things, give, pray, fast, and forgive, out of pride. Mm. I will receive nothing for it. Does it mean that I have to stop doing it? No, do it. But try to make the motivation more holy, more attuned with the Word of God. The Lord, at the beginning of the Lent, is telling us, yes, forgive, yes, give, pray, and fast as a personal, internal relationship between you and me. It's not about people at all. Mm-hmm. So don't concern yourself with people. Again, the church is always telling us, go and sit with your spiritual father. How to make it right? How to make everything on account of your eternal work, mish earthly one. Let me give you a simple example. The Lord said, if you give someone a glass of water, you have a reward in heaven. To bring you a glass of water, it takes a few seconds.
Mm.
But I can go and bring it for you with the intention and with maybe grumbling inside myself, why you are doing it for her.
Mm.
So I lost the few seconds, and maybe it became against me. If I will do it for the sake of my Heavenly Father, it has something totally different.
We're overthinking this glass of water so much.
Yeah. But he is telling me you can convert this few seconds from lost and maybe condemnation against you because you went grumbling to bring this glass of water into an eternal act, a heavenly act. It's your choice.
Mm-hmm.
If you work out your mind that everything and your Father who sees in secret will he himself reward you openly.
So we should do everything secretly.
Secretly, it doesn't mean that I'm hiding myself.
Right.
Hiding it from my heart, from my mind. I'm doing it and I feel wholeheartedly I'm not worthy to serve the children of God.
Mm.
And joyfully I'm doing it. Because sometimes we are withdrawing ourselves. I'm not worthy. So you are an idle member. You are not an active member of the body of Christ. So be active while you see in yourself that what I am doing, still I am doing it for my father, not to show off, not because I am better than anyone else or I am less than anyone else.
Well, Abuna, this has been very helpful. Thank you so much for joining us today and for answering all our questions and for preparing us for this blessed Lent. And with this, we will conclude today's episode on the series of Journey to the Resurrection. And we'll see you again next week as we continue this series with Abuna Mark. And see you then.